Recorded Books and RB Digital present Dealing in Dreams by Lilliam Rivera. Narrated by Marisol Ramirez. Chapter 1. Patrolling Mega. Tonight feels different. The weight of her absence hits me. On most nights, when my crew and I patrol the streets of Mega City, I feel a sense of invincibility mixed with glee. Violence can do that to a person, especially when you're the one unleashing it. At night, my crew, Las Mal Criadas, own these streets. Not tonight. We're missing one of our girls, and the warm breeze that blankets my face is a trick meant to seduce me into thinking everything is fine. My soldier, Manos Dura. She didn't have to go out like that. No one deserved that ending. Go check the building. Truck, my right hand barks out an order. One of my soldiers sprints ahead. It's been almost a month since the end of Manos Dura, and we're still feeling it. It was Truck who recruited and trained her to be the fifth in our all-girl gang. Manos Dura's specialty was her fists. No one ever wanted to catch them hands. She was good, and now she's gone. The last thing I want to do is be out here patrolling. Such is my lot in life. It's what Las Malcriadas do. Not for long, though. Does she see any stragglers? I ask shy. She checks the Código 5G goggles. The machine is run down, an old model. We're lucky to have them. Only top crews are authorized to be connected to the server. These códigos were a gift from Diese, our beloved leader of Mega City. We have access to the libraries and the ability to transmit. She says it looks pretty quiet, Chief Roca. Shai calls me by the title I earned as the leader of the baddest girl gang in Mega City. I hold the title close to my chest. I intend to keep it. Abandoned buildings line the streets, empty and menacing. There's no noise except for our boots crunching down on crumbling sidewalks. The nightly curfew is absolute. The people of Mega City are meant to be sleeping in their underground homes. No one is allowed to be out except for crews. From the northeastern tip of Mega City to close to the water, Las Malcriadas are in charge of maintaining curfew. Other crews take up different sections of the city. We've been at this for 5 years now. It never fails. We always find a toiler or two aimlessly lost on the streets, such as this woman who is curled in a fetal position against a slab of concrete. Her house dress is dirty. Her hair is a tangled mess of knots. "What the hell are you doing?" Truck yells. The woman wakes with a startled look. Truck grabs her by the arm and drags the woman to the nearest station. The woman pleads. She's so confused. Truck doesn't bother. She shoves the woman in. Her whimpering echoes up toward the street. I look away and stare at the mega towers, which stand tall, a trio of giant rectangular boxes. The towers are one of the few buildings that aren't falling apart. There are 536 apartments in the towers. There's even a school and a health center. Diese, the leader of Mega City, lives on the top floor. No one is allowed in without an invite. Soon I'll be living there, sleeping in a real bed, not on the dirt floor with Truck snoring on one side of me and another soldier talking in her sleep on the other. To be part of Diese's chosen guard, that's the prize, and I intend to grab it. We'll be chilling with the elite, the chosen few, and we will be no different from them. No more fighting other crews and no more dealing with lost toilers. The Mega Towers is where it's at. It's why we call it breaking night. There are times when you break a person back into sleeping. When the sun comes up, the grueling work begins again for this woman and the other countless toilers, whether it's making the sueño tabs in the factories or running mercados for people to trade for essentials. If you are in a crew, you're not considered a toiler. We are above them. When this woman wakes up in the morning, she'll be able to fulfill her duties because she'll feel the euphoric remnants from the manufactured dreams made by taking a sueño. Life is monotonous above ground. Everyone needs to dream in order to survive. Does Diese really live up there? Nena asks. Nena is our newest recruit, meant to replace Manos Dura. Truck is not convinced Nena has what it takes to be an LMC. She's 11, almost 12. She's got a hunger, a strong desire to please, and that's valuable. Still, Nena is too green to understand she shouldn't even be asking me questions. She should be soldiering. Recite the megacity history right now, I say. You should know this already. Nena rubs her forehead before speaking. We make every potential soldier study up on the history. No one is exempt. If you don't know your history, then you have no power. That's the problem with the other gangs. They think their strength lies only in their fists. Not my crew. I plan to take them straight to the top, and it will be because we outdid the rest with smarts. Before the big shake of 2060, men destroyed the city with their greed, Nena says. She looks up with her big eyes and waits for me to give her a nod to continue. The big shake happened, and everything was gone. We are the daughters of Mega City. We patrol because Diez's great-grandmother gathered everyone together. She trained women to defend themselves. We showed the men we didn't need them. Mega City was going to be for women. If they didn't like it, they could step. Good. Now why are the gangs made up of only 5 girls? I circle around her. She stands straight, hands to her sides, stiff. There were 4 who started Mega City with Diaz's great-grandmother. 5 leaders total, all women. She smiles to herself. Pleased she's getting it right. My other 2 soldiers, smiley and shy, look on. They're waiting for her to slip up. Also, 5 means grace. And how many gangs are there in Mega City? She stops and looks down. Nena doesn't remember the answer. Smiley starts to laugh loudly. They shake their heads. Manos Dura never had a problem when she recited the history. Nena is no Manos Dura. She might have been 12, but Manos never let age get in the way. She listened when she needed to, took notes, and studied them later. When things were quiet, she would ask me questions about everything. Her round face was filled with curiosity. Why do we keep her around? Truck pushes Nena to the ground. She can't even memorize facts. Nena stands with a rage face. The rage lasts only for a few seconds. She's so young. Go light up our way, I say. A disappointed Nena climbs up the lamppost and uses her mini blowtorch to light the lamp. She climbs down and jogs to the next one. Total waste, Truck says. We never had a problem with Mano. Mano had the history memorized in a day. She didn't play around. With the mention of her name, my heart starts to hurt again. It's true. Mano was a straight LMC from the first day. She anticipated what needed to be done. How was it possible the one time she needed to be extra alert, Mano had her defenses down? It was the deadly venoms. They caught Manos Dura on her way back from partying at the Luna Club. That night, we were so trashed. We were victorious in our last throwdown and things were looking up. One more battle with the deadly venoms and we would surely secure a spot in Diez's army. We were feeling good, unstoppable. When Manos Dura left the club early, we didn't think twice. We'd thought she left to sleep off the drinks over at our station. Instead, the deadly venoms intercepted her on her way and beat her down. By the time Mano's body was found, there wasn't much left. The only proof we had it was her was the LMC tattoo I personally branded on the side of her head. The deadly venoms didn't own up to doing the deed. We had no proof. Death. Our girl. My soldier.
Want one, Chief Roca?
Smiley offers me a food pellet. I decline. Smiley deals with the loss by eating. The gold grill covering her bottom row of teeth looks tarnished. Not brilliant like when she first made the trade after accumulating so many hundreds of sueño tabs. Smiley pulls out her cap and tags over a sign made by the deadly venoms. Of course they would use an audacious and tacky tag that's barely legible. Huge round bubble letters in their colors of black and pink appear as if written by a toddler. Smiley covers their ink and blazes the LMC in a solid graph style, clean and straight, with our colors of red and gold. The violence has been steady growing ever since we've been inching closer to Diese. It's one thing to fight in the public space during monthly scheduled throwdowns. It's quite another to cancel another gang member off hours. The deadly venoms are rotten to the core. There's no loyalty, no sense of rules, just anarchy. They've cheated and bashed their way to be placed in front of Diese. They won't last. They'll pay for what they did to Manos Dura. When that's done, we will be the top dogs of this city. I won't have to bloody my hands on trash anymore. I'll be next to my leader, in her army, keeping mega cities safe from the degenerates who live past the border in Semi territory.
Few more hours and I'm heading to the Luna Club, Truck says. Screw this patrol. Truck stands tall, with large arms and broad shoulders. It took everyone on my team to keep her from walking into Deadly Venom's neighborhood and ending them. There are times when Truck reacts so impulsively. She's been handling the death of Mana with more violence. Toilers are getting the brunt of it. Otherwise, Truck spends her time partying at the Luna Club. We each have our ways. Smiley presses her face up against a window of a building. It's a training camp for young girls to learn how to fight. The building is small. There are only a few official training camps in Mega City. The one Truck and I went through is farther east, and it is by far the biggest. Families from every corner travel to the camp in the hopes their daughter would be taken. If you can put up with the brutal training, you are guaranteed a place to sleep and eat. Most young girls come from nothing. The training camps at least teach you how to fight. It's not pretty, yet I made it through.
Let's wake them up, Smiley says with her mischievous grin. Smiley is short and round. A trickster. She loves to charm people into liking her and then stealing from them with her gold grin. She's also known to bite the crap out of opponents.
Nah, let's send Nina, Truck says. Trade her for a better model.
Truck says this loud enough for Nina to hear. Nina doesn't react. Good girl. She's got to learn these insults are only a small part of being one of us. Truck won't relent until Nina gets mad or gives up. Remember the time when Manos threw a mal suerte into their dorms? It was raining, and them young girls ran out screaming when the mal suerte blew up, Smiley says. Manos was ruthless. Smiley and Shy walk side by side. Their shoulders bump into each other. Manos would have been in the middle. The three of them, always up to no good. The girl was notorious. Manos convinced me to give up my Código 5G because she swore on everything mine was broken, Shy says. She tucks her long, dark bangs behind her ears. Her frame is slender, which makes her quick and hard to restrain in a throwdown. Made me think she was doing me a favor. Or the time she tricked me into thinking made in China meant a girl named China made the item, Smiley says. Got so busted when I tried to trade a pair of jeans I found in an abandoned building and got nothing for them. I suppress a laugh. Pay attention, I say instead of joining in. Shy and Smiley straighten up and concentrate on patrolling. I hold back from them and take a breather.
The pressure feels worse when they tell stories about Manos. Why didn't I stop her from going? I was too busy having a good time. We have to be on alert 24/7. Always. Can't stop thinking about her. Truck stands by me. Her eyes are red from lack of sleep during the day. And you? I won't stop until the deadly venoms pay for the pain. For our pain. We can't afford to get sloppy, I say. The deadly venoms are in it to win it, except they don't care how they do it. That's why you're Chief Roca. You strategize while I flex. She pulls off her helmet and goggles. Her dark brown, twisted locks now reach the center of her back. I sense a hint of anger in her tone. She thinks I'm being a coward for holding back on the deadly venoms. I'm only thinking of our future. Diez has surely heard what went down with Manos. If we retaliate outside of the throwdown, then we appear weak. We lack discipline. There's no doubt the upcoming fight will land in our favor and Diese will have no question as to who the better crew is. I continue to walk. In the distance, I can hear music pumping. There's a party going on in the towers. It's the same deal every night. Not only do Mega City's chosen guards live there, but so do many other elite. Engineers who develop ways to use wind and solar for electricity, urban farmers who create our food pellets, scientists who maintain the sueños to ease people's daily pain. If you're smart and can actually better the city, then Diese wants you close to her. It makes sense. Most toilers down here can barely read or write. Shy and smiley, go patrol the north side, I say. Let's finish this up. My two soldiers walk off. It's just me and Truck. When I decided to create the LMCs, the first person I turned to was Truck. We'd survived the training camp together. She knew me, and I knew her. When I stepped to her about the idea, she didn't even hesitate. I told her about my dream of living in the towers. This way of life was meant to be only temporary. Although she didn't quite see the future as I did, Truck trusted me enough to follow. Nalah, let's hit up Luna Club, Truck says. We deserve it. Manos would have wanted us to. Truck is the only person allowed to call me by my real name, Nalah. On the occasions when she does, she speaks as a friend and not as my second in command. Hearing my name keeps me grounded. Reminds me of our connection. I take a deep breath and slowly exhale. A cold drink and a hot dish. Maybe even a warm bath. The Luna Club sounds like the right type of action I need. Where's Nana? I say, suddenly realizing we hadn't seen or heard her in a bit. The street lamps she lit still glow. A few blocks away, there's only darkness. We listen. Do I hear a muffled cry? Truck gives me a look, and we bolt forward. We slow down when we hear Nana's voice. I give Truck the nod, and she pulls back, finds a concrete slab to crouch down behind, and waits. Ready.
Help me, Chief Roca, Nana says. Her tiny voice is a scratchy note on this hateful night.
A few yards ahead of me is a guy. He has one arm wrapped around Nena's neck. With his other arm, he yanks her hand back so hard tears stream down her face. Dumb girl. How did she get caught up in this stupidity? I knew in my gut Nena needed more training. She wasn't ready. Nena wanted to prove she was down. Now look at her. Only to knock this guy out because Nena can't soldier. Damn her for being such a rookie.
Please,
she yells. I tilt my head and start strategizing. Chapter 2. Hit 'em up. Nina is in a serious bind. With every cry, the man smirks.
This guy thinks he's got one up on us. He doesn't see my girl, Truck, holding a tricked-out Tronic aimed right at his junk. He thinks he's got lucky tagging Nena. The foolish act is going to be his downfall. I just need to give Truck the sign, and it's lights out. Let her go, I say.
I'm not scared of you, he says. I don't care. I'll break her little neck.
Nena's arms flail about, trying to land a hit. She's unable to make contact. I need to cut her loose soon before she truly freaks and trips him into committing a fatal act. It was only 2 days ago when we showed her how to break free from a bear hug by stomping the enemy's feet. Those hours of training are completely wasted if she doesn't calm down and formulate her next move. I'll think for both of us.
That soldier you're holding is mine, you hear me?
I keep my hand steady on my weapon, my beautiful silver Tronic, and point the laser beam at him, creating a neon pink dot on his forehead. The Tronic produces nanosecond electrical pulses meant to knock a person out. We don't have enough juice to kill anyone, but it's more than enough to cause a blackout. His eyes dart wildly, as if he's waiting for backup. He smells of a loner. Only fearless crews come out at this hour. Girls only. There is none more fearless than our crew. This guy's a fluke. I shoot above his head. He barely flinches. Nena screams. I should shoot her instead for causing such a ruckus. The next shot is going to be your face, I say. My black curls sneak in front of my goggles. I keep steady. I don't want to make any sudden moves. I'm not here for her, he sputters. Who are you? What's your name? He wears green, a common color for most toilers. However, his overalls are ripped and covered in muck. He looks to be in his mid-30s, way older than me. The tattoos on his knuckles are slightly faded. I can barely make out the T for toiler. There's no way he's a worker. The men in Megacity are relegated to manual labor. They work in the factories, hauling trash to the dumps. If they're smart, scientists or engineers, Diese will invite them to be part of her inner circle. This guy is exhibiting none of those traits. He is a garbage dweller scrounging for whatever he can steal. He's found a live one in Nena.
I'll let her go as soon as I find... I'm looking for...
He has a hard time completing his sentence. He must have snuck up on Nena when she tried to light our path. We taught her to use the large slabs of crumbled concrete as cover, or to walk alongside the multitude of empty buildings. You can never be too sure if another crew is hiding, holding their buffalo stance on a desolate lot, waiting to jump you. We're here to make sure no one makes false claims on our section of the city. With Diese living in our neighborhood, life for us is way easier and more comfortable than in other parts of the city. We've got the best Boydega clubs and a better selection at the Mercado. Unfortunately, we divide the neighborhood with the deadly venoms. A temporary thing until we beat them in the next throwdown. The other sections of the city can't compare. Crews have tried to muscle in. They fail every time.
You're breaking curfew, I say. Everyone in the city is asleep. You need to join them.
I inch closer to him. His eyes and lips are awash in blue. Soon his skin will turn an ashy gray. I should have known. He is an anonymous, nervous toiler. An ant. A toiler addicted to sueños. Sueños are meant only to ease people into sleep and to alleviate pain. Weak people abuse the tabs and end up wanting to live in a euphoric state of fantasy forever. I've seen the strongest succumb to the temptation. From the look of his disheveled state, this ant's desperate for another trip into dreamland. A message from Truck appears on the screen of my goggles, asking permission to attack. I let her wait. I don't want the mess.
He'll harm Nena. The aunt's smirk disappears and becomes a grimace. Just what I thought. He's in pain. Nothing but an aunt caught up in the sueño cycle, where there are never enough tabs to keep him going. I have no pity.
Okay, relax. We can work this out. I'll help you find the person you are looking for.
I slowly lower my tronic. He loosens his grip on Nena. He's doing exactly what I want him to do.
That's right.
Keep thinking you're winning this fight, Aunt. Keep dreaming.
See? I'm listening to you, I say. No problem.
His stormy eyes are so focused on the tronic, he doesn't notice how my other hand reaches behind for my baton.
Legs up, I say calmly to Nena.
Kneeling, I throw my baton toward his leg just as Nena pulls up hers. The baton hits his ankle with a loud thump. He buckles down in pain while Nena manages to break free. As I step to him, the aunt rushes toward me. I don't wait to see if he has a weapon. I grab hold of his arm and kick him where my baton landed. The pain is enough to cause him to cringe. While holding his hand, I turn away from him, pull him toward my back, and bend my knees. He's lighter than I thought, light enough to flip. His head makes a horrible smacking sound as the ground knocks the wind out of him. Without missing a beat, Truck catches up to us, straddles him, and gives him a punch to the side of his head. As quickly as it began, the ant is out for the count. Too easy. I'm only a few feet away from him, and his stench makes my eyes tear. I adjust my goggles to cover my nose. This ant is our third victim of the night. He better be my last.
I didn't know he was behind me, I swear, Chief Roca, Nena says. I'm so sorry. Please, don't get mad at me. I didn't see him. It's not my fault.
Shut up, soldier. You should know better than to let an ant take hold of you,
Truck yells at her.
You're never going to be a true malcriada. We should send you right back where we found you.
Nena tries to muffle her cries, nearly hyperventilating with the effort.
Do your thing, Nena,
I say firmly. She's the youngest in our outfit. She has to wise up, get hard, or get dumped. Nena wipes her tears with the back of her hand while Truck looms over her. She removes her bomber jacket and ties it around her waist, exposing her thin arms covered in thick metal cuffs similar to the gold cuffs I wear. She puts on her gloves and walks over to the ant. She empties his pockets.
He got used tabs, Nena says in a shaky voice. Garbage. Garbage.
Garbage?
Wait. There is an object around his neck.
She pulls out her knife to release the item.
Can I keep this? She asks.
Nena dangles a necklace in front of me. A miniature black fist charm hangs from a crude leather cord.
Wait, I've seen this charm before.
Where? I scan my head, going over the other gangs.
Is it an emblem from another crew?
No. I've never seen anyone rock this fist. So strange.
Give me that. Truck grabs the piece from Nena.
Truck is never one to play it cool. If she's not unleashing blood on an enemy, she's turning on those who are close to her. It's hard to keep her anger in check. We've been together since we were recruited by one of Diez's scouts when we were 7, almost 10 years ago. I vaguely remember my recruiter. She had a nice smile. There was nothing hard about her, not what you would expect from a person whose job was to find the roughest. I never saw her again. She must be in the towers. Recruiters continue to go station to station, assessing families with daughters. Not every girl is selected. You can't be sickly or harbor any weird flaws. Only a lucky few can catch a break. The girls who aren't selected must figure out how to make themselves useful. Work in the sueño factories, feed the soldiers.
What are you looking at? Truck yells.
Nena quickly moves away from Truck after getting caught staring at the guy. There's not a day that goes by without Nena getting scolded for not paying attention. She quickly gets distracted. Nena searches for members of her family. An aunt, perhaps. A distant cousin? As Nena tells it, she woke up one day and her parents and younger brother were gone. A note was left with the word, "Semi." Nothing else. How can a family just pack up and head toward violence and uncertainty in Semi territory when Diese provides us with everything? Nena's family is probably dead by now. I went through a similar period when I was Nena's age. My sister did the same thing to me. She left without so much as a word when I was 6. I didn't even get the courtesy of a note. 10 years ago, I don't feel the loss. Once a person crosses the border, they are as good as dead. The crew is Nena's only family, and mine. Nena snaps a picture of the aunt. I watch as she taps with frustration at her Código 5G, cursing how the equipment isn't working right. The Código will scan faces of megacity residents and see if there's a match. I listen for noise. Any person hiding might be connected to him. It's deadly quiet. We are alone on this street. Truck twirls the necklace. A slight feeling of anxiety grows inside of me. I can't place the fist. His name is drawing up blank, Nena says. She cocks her head to the side. Nena has the tendency to end her sentences as if she's asking a question and not answering one. Searching the other libraries? I'm not having much luck. He has no people. I'll do a search on the necklace. Nena takes another picture. I adjust my choker and stroke the embossed LMC lettering, a gift given to me by one of Diez's assistants after our last throwdown. I study the ant. His appearance holds no clue, just dirt and blue lips cracked from dryness. His body jerks from sueño withdrawal. Most men will show their preferred gang with ink on their right arm. His arms are bare. "Whoa," Nena says. "You're not going to believe this." "Seriously? This is crazy." "Spit it out," I say. "The necklace belongs to the Ashe Riders." My heart sinks. "The Ashe Riders," Truck says. "There's no way the skinny mocoso is associated with the Ashe. No way." "Have you ever met an Ashe?" Nena asks. "In the flesh?" Nena instantly regrets asking the question after the scowl Truck throws her way for trying to start a conversation. No one in my crew or anyone we know has run into an Ashe rider. The stories on the Ashe are legendary. From conjuring natural elements to destroy their enemies to burning their dissenters alive. The tales are bogeyman stories, though, told to keep people in check. Apparently, the Ashe Riders were a regular crew until they started to get too big. This happened way before I was born. I learned about the Riders' history while training in the camp to become a soldier. Greed is what Diez said was the root of their collapse. They were run out of Mega City many, many years ago for going against the people and starting a riot. Now they're in Semi territory, or what's left of them. No one ventures outside of Mega City for fear of running into an Ashe. Diez's army has kept the borders tight, and everyone in Mega City safe within. The degenerates who live outside in Semi territory serve only as reminders of how lost they are in their brutality. There's no sense of community, only violence. The same violence almost destroyed Mega City. Ashe Riders are no different from the hundreds who chose anarchy over order. "We should try to wake him up," I say. "Ask him where he got it." "Why?" Truck says, annoyed. "He probably stole it. Are you questioning me?" Truck steps down while Nena stares nervously at her boots. After a few seconds of awkward silence, Truck walks over to me, speaking quietly so that Nena will not hear.
Nalah, we are both beat. We need to chill, she says. This aunt probably found the necklace and wanted to trade it for more sueños. I'm telling you, he's not worth it. Right now, all I see is an addict. We followed Diez's orders and slip him a tab so he won't crash too hard from withdrawal, okay? I take a deep breath and slowly exhale. I'm letting my emotions cloud the correct action to take. Truck is right, but I can't seem to shake that I'm missing a sign. Why is this silly necklace stirring doubt in me? As if this addict holds information I should know. It's dumb. I must be tired. It's been a long night. The sun will soon rise. Breaking night will be over. I need to check in on Shy and Smiley. I study the ant again. His grimace stays plastered on his face. I'm being paranoid. It's a simple charm representing a crew that no longer holds any power in Mega City. The old school ways of doing things were destroyed in the big shake. The past is truly dead. There's only Las Malcriadas, our leader, Diez, and my goal to make it to the towers. Okay, I say. Mark him. Nena takes out her cap and tags our letters on his left arm, our normal procedure whenever we run into a guy with no allegiance. When he comes to, he'll forever bear the mark of the LMC on him, an indicator to everyone we crushed him first. I'll take that. Truck sulks as she reluctantly hands me the necklace. Although the black fist charm is small, it weighs heavily in the palm of my hand. This is my city, and I intend to defend it to the end. There are throwdowns to bet on and boydegas to party in. No one goes without, not even the addicts. There is a citywide distribution of food pellets, an abundance of underground stations for families to live in. You cobble together a crew of strong girls and create a life worth living. It's simple. This is due to Diez's vision. We owe her. Maybe this necklace will prove valuable. Nena creeps over with a shy smile, the remnants of her assault already forgotten. Her eyes are large and green, almost alien-like. She's tiny for an 11-year-old. I want to protect her. Her skills for soldiering are sorely lacking. I'm giving her a chance because I believe, in time, she can be a strong LMC. It's probably a weakness on my part. It's pretty, she says. Do you think Diez will want it? I rub her shaved head, feeling the tattoo still raw from when we branded her last week. Her green eyes pop against her sunburnt skin. He didn't hurt me, she says when I inspect the emerging black and blue marks around her neck left by the ant. The bruises will only get worse by tomorrow. At least she'll have a good story to tell the others. Sure he didn't, I tease. It seemed as if you were handling the situation, especially when he had his arms wrapped around you. I'm reluctant to walk away. Do you think it's enough to get us to the towers? Nena asks. We've beaten those other crews. That's gotta be enough.
Stop asking Chief Roca stupid questions, says Truck. You're never gonna live in the towers. You can't even follow orders. Keep quiet and move.
Nena scurries to gather what's left on the ant to sell. I remember when I was as young as Nena, a skinny thing trying to roll with the big girls. I got beat down so much when I spoke out of turn. I soon learned to punch first and punch hard. It was the fight in me that made me Chief Roca. In our weekly newsletter from Diez, there are always images of former Mega City residents who took their chances in Semi. True violence, body parts, real hunger. The Ashe Riders have stayed in Semi territory with the other degenerates for years. Now is not the time for them or anyone to appear. Let's roll.
If the Ashe Riders are itching to creep into Mega City, Truck yells, they're going to have to contend with Las Malcriadas. Mal, I yell. Criadas! Nena and Truck respond with our signature call. I shove the necklace into my pack and head toward the direction where Smiley and Shy should be waiting. Chapter 3. Boydega Dreams. We stand in front of the entrance to the Luna Club. Doña Chela squints at us. She wears her usual uniform of a grungy bathrobe and slippers. She's an old-timer. We've lost many bets trying to guess how old she is. Doña refuses to reveal her age. It doesn't help that she's missing various teeth and that her hair is a disheveled nest dyed a putrid green. Bendición, Doña, I ask for her blessing. My tiny show of respect is mandatory. She owns the most popular Boydega club in Mega City. I must shower her with love even when my crew is one of her regulars. My girl's been playing rough tonight, huh? Doña inspects us with her lime green eyes made to match her hair. I wonder how much she was willing to trade to get those colored contacts. Those who live in the towers love changing the color of their eyes. Doña probably has a tower connection for petty beauty accessories like this one. She points a chubby finger at me. Where are the rest of your girls, Chief Roca? You should let them have fun, too. Provocative images of guys in various forms of undress cover the walls of the Boydega from their latest calendar, the Papi Chulos of Luna Club. One papi flexes his muscles, another admires himself in a full-length mirror, and another sucks on a lollipop. When I was young and lived in the training camp, Papi Chulo trading cards were given to those on good behavior. I collected the cards and traded with others, professing my undying love for my favorite. My preference always leaned towards the papi dressed as a scholar by way of thick, black-rimmed glasses and an open book on his lap. He looked smarter and hence more approachable. The chulos here are kept forever young with a fresh crop of candidates willing to strike a pose. I peel off my jacket, remove my cuff, and thrust my arm under the detector. I can't shake the uneasiness I've felt since a run-in with the aunt. I sent Nena, Smiley, and Shy back home. Nena's carelessness caused the rest of them to get screwed out of papi action. Doña Chela offers a toothless grin when the mandatory bell rings the rank of our crew. Only the top five gangs gain VIP entrance to this particular club. Everyone else who wants to party in the Luna Club must contend with begging for access. If you're not VIP, expect to wait hours to get in, if you get in at all. The embedded numerical rank placed under my skin is proof of our worth. With every throwdown, Diese and her inner circle determine your crew's rank. There are currently about 15 registered crews in Mega City, each ranked in order. Unregistered crews are not worth a mention. I've been to underground bodegas when Las Malcriadas were just starting 5 years ago. The chulos were so ugly and dirty. There are Mega City residents who don't approve of bodegas, which is hard to believe. Instead, they cut loose with the rumberos over by the water. A religious group, the rumberos, spend way too much time dwelling in the spiritual mumbo-jumbo instead of reality. They are a small, forgettable bunch. The Luna Club is legit. There's good food, music, and potent drinks. There are sueño tabs, too, if you're into that. My crew stays far away from sueños. We keep our minds clear of manufactured dreams. It's a decree I made when I started the gang. I've seen firsthand how sueños can destroy a person. I won't stay long tonight, though. Just long enough to return to my normal self, not shook because of a dumb charm. What other mocosas are here trying to uglify your home, Doña? Truck asks as she checks in her weapon.
Truck loves the club. Here, the chulos think Truck is the bomb. She plays drinking games with them or wrestles. She's generous with the papis, to the point one summer I cut her off for trading too much of her sueño supply. Sueños are our top currency. With every throwdown won, we get paid in tabs. Since Diese provides us with food and we carve our own shelter, there is no need for old school money. Still, we can't spend tabs carelessly. That summer, the battles were pretty dull, so Truck went kind of nuts with boredom. She handed out tabs as candy. It got so bad I had to block her from entering the club for a whole month. Nowadays, I allow her a little bit of leeway. Not much.
Nobody's here, just a couple of my girls. Quiet. I think everyone is getting ready for this weekend.
Doña accepts my sueño tabs and chucks them into her purse. She calls gang members, no matter what affiliate, her girls. Doña doesn't have any children of her own, although she gives a motherly vibe. I don't have that type of relationship with her, and I don't let my soldiers be seen that way. We don't need mothers. We only need each other.
We've got a special tonight, she says. If you buy two, you get the third chulo at half price.
There won't be any sales on the day of the throwdown. In fact, she'll make renting a papi twice as expensive. That's when everyone will want papi action. I'm glad the club is empty. For the most part, boydegas are neutral territory. No one is supposed to fight. Of course, things get stirred up from time to time. How could they not when you have rival crews hanging in one spot? Not tonight. Everyone will save their aggression for the throwdown this weekend. The booming bass from a popular song rattles the gilded mirrors lining the stairs leading down to the club. I catch my reflection and see the long, jagged scratch left by the last lost toiler. Kicking her felt justified. My black curls lay limp. I look tired and run down, much older than 16.
Ugly, Truck says. She ruffles my curls.
I follow her down the stairs. Giant paper animals hang from the ceiling. Massive tigers and lions, pandas and kangaroos, each with a maniacal grin. When the place is jumping, with people crushed side to side on the dance floor, Doña Chela usually invites the victors to bash the giant animals and shower the partygoers with candy laced with happiness. Unlike the synthetic sueños, the candy has a natural high, consisting mostly of THC. On this subdued night, the giant animals stay put. The massive piñatas turn their heads as if they are watching us. Truck elbows me. A couple dances in the center of the club. I recognize the deadly venom colors, black and pink, on the drunken girl. The chulo she leans on tries his best to keep her steady. She's by herself, Truck says. I shake my head, signaling to Truck she's not worth it. The couple continues to dance. I sit at our table a little away from the dance floor.
What's going on with you? Truck says after taking a large gulp from her drink. You've been with a sour expression. We need to get pumped for this weekend. It's on!
She pats my back hard. The throwdown this weekend is by far our most important one. We've sparred our way to this very moment, beating other crews and proving we're the best. The deadly venoms are hopefully the last obstacle for us to overcome before we step to the towers. The stakes are too high for us to mess up. I want to live in the towers. It's what I've been dreaming most of my soldiering life. We've never been this close to having this dream realized. I can see it becoming my reality. No one else sees it as clearly as I do. Truck is too busy thinking of what's going on right now, beating so-and-so, drinking and fooling around with chulos. I'm thinking about our future, of my whole crew's destiny.
battling gangs for a measly crumb is dead. Once we're set up in the towers, we can watch other crews bash each other's heads. Truck is wrong in thinking this weekend's throwdown with the deadly venoms is just another fight. We're not only avenging Manos Duras' death, but we are proving once and for all we're worthy enough to live in the towers. We can't just beat the deadly venoms. We've got to put them on display, I remind her. Don't stress, Roca. We've got this. It's a wrap. Truck stands. We've got this. I'm going to... No, we don't got a thing. I pound my fist on the table. It's important we show we're smart. You feel me? Truck settles back down into her seat. She places her hand on my shoulder, a rare gesture that would embarrass others. Truck is fearless in that way, not afraid to show a bit of vulnerability. Don't worry. I'm here. We'll get to the towers, she says. No one else comes close. They're even proclaiming our name. It's true. Most walls across the city are tagged with our initials, LMC. More and more residents are sporting our colors of red and gold as a show of solidarity. The LMC has a reputation of playing things straight and fair. Even if the attack de Manos was never proven to be by the deadly venoms, it was cause enough for most of the residents of Mega City to despise them. I should feel good about this. Then why do I feel as if my plans are held by the thinnest of ropes? Anxiety rises, gnawing at me, telling me the bloody favors I've made along the way will never be enough. I look at Truck. There is never any doubt, only confidence. I wish I were like her. I won't sleep until I hear it straight from Diese, I say. It's a done deal. No, I cut her off. We need to be laser focused. If we're not careful, we'll end up old-timers, homeless, unable to contribute to Mega City after one too many throwdowns. We've got to protect ourselves and shape what we want our tomorrows to be. I am, Truck mumbles after a pause. She pulls her hand away and gestures over to a chulo to bring us more drinks. If Truck is nervous, she'll never tell. What are you tired cows doing here? The drunken, deadly venom pulled away from her chulo and now points at our table. The drink is giving her courage. Let's go dance, the chulo urges. The deadly venom refuses. No. I want to talk to them, she slurs. Las malcriadas are a bunch of played-out girls who can't fight. Just wait until you see what we're going to do to you. This deadly venom is barely 12. There are no scars or marks on her. She must be a new soldier, as green as Nina. I want to warn her, to tell her no matter how many soldiers she knocks out, there will be another one waiting to strike her down. I want to tell her she's young enough to bail. This life is definitely not for everyone. The sueño factories aren't that bad. There's time to carve a decent, if boring, life as a toiler. Instead, I keep quiet. The deadly venom lunges toward us. She bumps into our table and tips over our drinks. Truck looks at me. To let this soldier go would mean to show weakness. It doesn't matter how green she is or if she acts alone. I must play the part. I get up and shove the deadly venom hard. Before the young girl has a chance to figure out her next move, I straddle her and throw a flurry of punches to her side, then toward her chest and ears. The girl tries to protect her face. I stop when her blood covers my knuckles. Go home, or I'll end the night with you, I say. Tell your leader we're ready for this weekend.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.